From AIT Studios in Abuja, Nigeria, this is the O&M Late Show with Obiora Ilo and Mamode Akuga.
Hello and welcome to the O&M Late Show, and it's the Friday night edition. My name is Mamode Akuga, and of course, as usual, Obiora Ilo is here with me. Obiora.
Thank you, Mamode. How are you today?
Beautiful, wonderful Friday night. The eve
it's like
of
you're,
Valentine's.
You're all ready for Valentine. It's a busy day in Abuja.
Valentine is tomorrow, and a lot of lucky people out there will be having a swell time.
I think that a lot of Nigerians are actually celebrating because the elections would have made it almost uncelebratable.
And did you see all the joke online? Mm-hmm. Sending all sorts of jokes about people, about men who were so excited that, you know, the elections were going to disrupt the Valentine's. And all of a sudden, the elections are postponed, and now they have to settle the ladies on Valentine's Day.
Well, we will celebrate Valentine tomorrow, but tonight we've got business to do.
Yes, we got business to do.
There's been this whole talk about what level of involvement should the international community have with the electoral process in Nigeria. Mamode, you've heard the American ambassador moving around the country, getting people to sign peace pacts and what have you.
And of course, the American government, the Secretary of State, Mr. Kerry, having very, very harsh words for Nigeria after the postponement, describing it as very disappointing, regardless of whatever the reasons were, as very disappointing. So we've had, reactions from across the world about our elections.
Of course, we have monitors, international monitors all over the country.
Yes. But, Obiora, the Nigerian government reacted through a briefing by, the Nigerian Minister of External Affairs, Ambassador Aminu Wale, calling all diplomats in Nigeria and then issuing them very stern warning.
We have guests with us today who will be looking at that involvement, the implications, whether it should happen the way it's happening, whether it should happen a different way. We have two very senior diplomats, retired diplomats, Nigerian diplomats.
People who have been in Nigerian Foreign Service all their lives. First, we have a former Nigerian ambassador to the Philippines, to Thailand, Ambassador Ademola Aderele, retired diplomat, will be joining us. Also, joining us later today, the immediate past Permanent Secretary of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Ambassador Martins Uhomoibhi. I'm sure I got it right. But and of course, joining us later.
Yes, we also have
a three-man panel.
It's a three-man panel. Okay, yes. A three-man-woman panel, actually, because the third person is a woman. Yemi is representing the civil society. She is a civil society advocate. She's been around. She was part of the Nigerian delegation that interfaced with the State Department in the United States about a year ago. Yemi will be here to talk about that. And we also have talking about the preparedness of INEC as we wait for the suspended, deferred,
or the unpreparedness, if I may say so.
Yes, the preparedness or unpreparedness
of INEC.
We have the director voter registration of INEC joining us much later. But I don't know if you saw the internet today. Mm. It's been trending everywhere that Nigeria lost one of our foremost royal fathers,
the
Oba of Benin.
After
some hours, we got news from the from the palace that is all fabu, as they say, is all lies. That the revered king is hale and hearty. Of course, there was the rumor that he didn't receive the president when he was there not too long ago.
You know, and this type of rumors, you know, ordinarily, if anything like that, as the palace secretary did it, say, the council, the traditional council in Benin, secretary, Mr. Irabo, did say that if there was anything like that, it is the council that will make that known. So put your mind to rest, everybody. It's not true. The Amonoba Nedo is hale and hearty. Well, Obiora, we talked about the Assistant Inspector General of Police Zone 2 few editions ago on this program.
He's on the news again.
He's in the news again. Likes talking tough. The man who says that he's not a controversial police officer. I'm talking about Joseph Mbu. He says, if anybody makes the mistake of getting down one of his officers, and by that I mean that if any of his officers lose their life during the duties for the election period, he's going to ensure that 20 Nigerians die
as a consequence to that. Well, he also went ahead to say that the immunity of state governors ended before they got into the polling booths, and told his officers to make sure that they arrest any governor who comes to any polling booth. Why is this man so controversial?
Joseph,
and I was asking, is the immunity, is the polling booth not part of Nigeria?
Well, we'll see how all that will play out during the elections, whether indeed Joseph Ubu
will arrest governors
if they don't behave the way he said.
Anyway, Mamode, we have to get Mbu to this studio.
He has to talk to us. We have to get him to this studio.
Because I think he must be a very interesting character.
No, but he's a very, very interesting character.
And that's what I hear. His friends say he's a wonderful guy.
I met him.
In Port Harcourt.
Yes, he came visiting the office, you know, immediately came to Port Harcourt. You know, I spoke with him, had a chat with him. Nice fellow, really.
I think we should bring Mbu to this studio.
We will. and then... yes, the Joint Task Force, the multinational Joint Task Force, so issues with
Niger.
The
Nigerians saying that the Nigerian soldiers are cowards, and Olukolade won't take that.
I won't take that, and then he describing the Nigerian soldiers as looters, and accused them of providing fighters to Boko Haram. Well, this is not what we expect to see from a joint military operation,
especially when we are battling with Boko Haram.
Yes.
They should synergize.
We expect,
and not waste their time talking down.
Cooperation. We expect that, you know, joint force against Boko Haram if they are to succeed.
Well, that's what's been trending. We told you that today we are talking about international community's involvement in our elections, and we are looking at the preparedness or unpreparedness of INEC. All that when we return. Don't go away.
Sometimes I lay under the moon. I thank God I'm breathing. And I pray, don't take me soon, 'cause I am here for a reason. Sometimes in my tears I drown, but I never let it get me down. So when negativity surrounds, I know someday it'll all turn around, because
still the O&M Late Show, and that piece from the internet you saw there, kindness does go around. So if you do, if you're kind to somebody today, that kindness will most likely go around and get back to you eventually. That's the message from that clip you saw. And now we get down to brass tacks, our first issue to look at today. And we'll be bringing on set now the immediate past permanent secretary of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Ambassador Martin Uhomoibhi. Also joining him will be Ambassador Ademola Aderele, former Nigerian ambassador to the Philippines and Thailand.
And of course, we have from the civil society, Yemi Ademaleko of the Enough is Enough organization. Gentlemen, please.
And lady.
please join us. Yemi, you're welcome. Please.
I think Yemi should be in the middle.
Yes. Your Excellency, you're welcome.
Thank you very much indeed.
Please.
Excellency.
Pleasure. See you.
Your Excellency, you're welcome. Yeah.
Okay. Welcome, sir.
You know, I want to start this conversation with a little story His Excellency told us off camera about when he arrived as a student, I think in Canada.
Australia.
In Australia.
Oh, okay.
Oh, in Oxford. Yes. Okay, oh. So they had this issue with your name. Tell us the story. Because I was supposed to introduce you, but I did a poor job of it, so Mamode had to take over.
Let me say first of all a big thank you to AIT for having me on this show. My name is Martin Uhomoibhi. My name Uhomoibhi has always been, there's always stories around it, different renditions have been given by nationalities and races to this kind of name. So when I got to school in a small village in England in 1979, the first teacher I had, this was of course in Oxford, asked, where are you coming from? I said, I'm from Nigeria. What part of Nigeria are you coming from? I said, I'm from the center of the universe in Nigeria State. And he said, what's your name? I said, Martin. I mean, what is your name? My name is Martin, sir. What is your Nigerian name? Yeah. I said, please, it will be very complicated. It's a very difficult name to pronounce. He said, can you write it out for me? So I did. And he said, that's pretty easy. I said, wow. It means, this is, who may you be? I will never forget this Australian for turning my name into a, you know, such a joke, but it served good purpose anyway. Thank you.
Okay, so let's come to the topic now. You had quite a wonderful career in the Foreign Service.
Thank you.
And today, Nigeria is the agenda. Mm-hmm. You hear comments here and there, and I know you've seen it all. How would you react to the reactions of the international community, for instance, when we extended or postponed our election?
Well, again, thank you for that very pertinent question. It's been a privilege and an honor to carry the Nigerian flag for more than 30 years in the diplomatic service. Five of these in my capacity as permanent secretary. It's been a matter of pride and honor to work for this great country called Nigeria. This is the most populous black nation on earth. 170 million black men and women in one part of the world. And a country with such an elegant history. A country that is peaceful, peace-loving, caring, giving, sharing, and loving. That's all our history. If we have any brand in the international arena, it is as a peacekeeping nation. The resources that we have is not an awful lot, but we have shared with all and sundry. Our immediate neighbors, our ECOWAS neighbors, African nations, and even far-flung places like Fiji and the Caribbean in their moments of difficulties. So it has been an extreme honor and pleasure for me to work carrying the flag of Nigeria. It is not surprising at all that anything that happens here tends to attract international interest and attention. But what we are seeing today is a bit extraordinary. I don't know whether you want me to speak to the issue of the elections and all of that.
Yes. But that's what we want you to.
But it does amaze me because I have argued that we are a democratic demography. We are not autocrats in this country. If you look at our traditional institutions and our history before colonization, they were of a people who loved inclusiveness as part of their ethical way of behaving. We're an inclusive people. We don't eat alone. The colonial intervention completely distorted our ways of behavior. And of course, when we fought and got our independence in 1960, we're back to exhibiting our true Nigerian self. So as a democratic demography, and democratic demographies don't easily produce democratic governments, because that narrows down the expanse of democracy.
How do you mean? I'll
come down to that. So we decided in 1979, out of our own free will, that we wanted to return to continuous democracy, stable democratic governance. It was a decision that Nigerians took. It was not imposed on us. And since then, we've had four great elections, each one getting better by the day. And of course, the 2011 one was adjudged by Nigerians, and those outside Nigeria has been the fairest and the best that we've had. And this administration, and this is talking as a Nigerian, and as a just retired civil servant, has demonstrated a tolerance and a desire to expand the space of democracy. And that's why we are signatory to the Freedom of Information Act. And no, there is not one political prisoner that I know of, no journalist, nobody who is in prison because he has expressed his opinion. This is unusual in our history. So I think the excitement about the minor rescheduling of the date of election is completely, maybe a little bit out of order. And I think that if a sovereign government decides on its own that because of the logic of the situation, it wants to modify the date consistent with the constitution of the country without tampering with the ultimate goal, which is to have a change of government by a fixed date, I think we should give that government space.
Okay. All right. Yemi, I don't know whether you share in this view. There are people who say the world has become a global village, getting smaller and smaller by the day. Some people would like to see this as a situation where, you know, what affects somebody in another country, people from a completely different country can have reactions to it. I don't know, these reactions from the international community about our postponement and the excitement, as His Excellency talked about it just now, do you see them as being, a little bit out of place?
Not at all. And I think it's a bit hypocritical on our part when it's okay to accept international comments when it's positive, but when it's negative, then we then suddenly realize we're a sovereign nation. Yes, nobody doubts our sovereignty. We're a sovereign nation, yes. But at the same time, as you said, we also live in a global village. And especially when it comes to issues of elections, which are not just about just within our territorial boundaries, but speaks to the issue of human rights and democratic rights. I think from the same body who we collect aid from, or financial support, to actually run these same elections. So Nigerian elections are not run solely on Nigerian money. We get money from the UK, from the US, and other countries in various ways that do they support the process.
Purely for observation?
No, not just observation. Like they're helping with INEC, for example. They're helping with training. They're helping with systems. They're helping with processes. So there are a variety of things that they're helping with in terms of making sure as we desire. We want free, fair, credible, and peaceful elections. Unfortunately, I mean, I think it was also actually on this show earlier in the day that the chairman of the National Human Rights Commission was on, talking about the fact that all of our elections have been marred with some level of violence. So having peaceful elections is extremely important, especially now in Nigeria, given the insurgency in the Northeast. So that being said, for me, I mean, we talk about 2011 elections and that the fact that it was adjudged, as the ambassador just said as well, adjudged by Nigerians and the international community as free and relatively free and fair. I mean, he mentioned four elections. We've actually had five that have been Nigerians will call great. 1993 cannot be discarded, even though the mandate wasn't given. But really, it's arguably that was the freest and fairest election that we've had to date, because winner was clear, there was no violence posted, well, if the announcement had been made as it should have been. But that being said, I think it's for nations that we have relationships with, that yes, every nation has their own interest. I mean, you might say you care about what happens in Nigeria, but it ties to your own personal or your own national interest as well. So if they have a right to give us money and we collect it, if we have a right in a sense to have a conversation around our elections, I mean, US Senator Kerry was here a few weeks ago. President Jonathan and General Buhari went to Lagos to meet with them, had a conversation around the elections. So if those kind of things are okay, when things then turn around and they express what the things are concerned for, the reasons given for the elections being postponed, and also just ensuring that we don't get in this. Nigerians are also concerned about the elections being postponed. So I don't think it's out of, they're not going out of sort of making things up, to put it that way.
Your Excellency, there are two extremes now, so to say. Yeah. Sovereignty and the global village, where what happens in Nigeria impacts on several nations. Where do we draw the line for especially your colleagues in the diplomatic corps? Where should we draw the line with what is the internal affairs of a country and what is what the international community should be doing?
Thank you very much. I'll go back to the general convention that regulates diplomatic relations among countries. As an ambassador or representative of your country, you are here to represent your country, and you have anything you wish to say in Nigeria, there's a channel through which you have to say it, which is the Minister of Foreign Affairs. And actually, your job here is to report to your government through your reports. We are not in the age of governor generals in colonies. We're all independent countries. I served as an ambassador in about three countries. I can't remember any time I came out to pontificate on their local affairs. So it is not proper for any foreign ambassador to comment openly on affairs of his receiving state. If you have anything to say, either as an offer of advice or a protestation, there's a channel for it, practiced worldwide. Why is Nigeria different? Now I come to this to a point. Nigeria, as the ambassador said, is very important geopolitically. It's a regional power. Africa, where it is, Nigeria cannot be wished away. So whatever happens in Nigeria attracts international attention. If you recall, some years ago there was a prediction that Nigeria may disintegrate in this year. That is how this hoopla started. We've always had elections. We've always had postponement of elections. 2010, 2011, about three times before this one. It is that prediction which can never come to pass, because Nigeria is a resilient country, that has caused this hoopla. And how can an ambassador of another country go and be interacting with local dignitaries, organizations, presiding over their meetings or pursuing seminars, local affairs. It is wrong. It is not done. You see, it's an attempt to rubbish our sovereignty. And we have to condemn this. Nigerians as people have not complained that we have problem. In fact, from this fourth republic, we have been having continuous improvement in our democratization. And participation in participatory democracy has been deepening and widening. Look at what we have right now. 2011 election, people are judged as free and fair. There was a lot of participation, but look at the number of registered voters in millions that want to vote in Nigeria now, which is bigger than that of 2011, which means Nigerians are becoming
politically aware.
Aware. Okay. And it is Nigerians themselves that are taking decisions, individuals. So we don't need to be educated on anything. Is there anything wrong with Nigeria? Ask this question. What is wrong with Nigeria today? Nothing. We are just talking. We have a security problem in the Northeast caused by Boko Haram. Okay. Look at Afghanistan. They had election. Pakistan, they hold election. There are so many areas of the world where you have
crisis.
They do hold election. But in fact, we are giving something to the world that we want a correct environment for people to exercise their voting rights. Okay. That is why we find it expedient that each person should have his permanent voting card. That is the question. And for them to vote, the environment must be secured.
Okay. Ambassador Uhomoibhi. He said something when I was talking about ambassadors going around and taking part in local activity. I think that just thinking right now, I could easily recall, for instance, the American ambassador to Nigeria.
And Twistle.
Going to Lagos State and getting the from the consulate in Lagos to sign a peace pledge between the PDP and the APC, you know, and supervising it personally and getting that pledge, a lot of people say that is good intention, trying to secure peace in an election, but speaking diplomatically now, is it proper?
My very senior colleague Aderele already made it very clear what the Vienna Conventions state about diplomatic duties and all of that. To the best of my knowledge, that's not part of diplomatic duty of an ambassador. An ambassador is, when I go out to Switzerland as Nigeria's ambassador to Switzerland, I carry President Jonathan's letter of credence. And when I speak in that country, I speak for him. I do not participate or get myself involved in local issues. If I am interested, I go to the foreign ministry. And there are recognized channels, diplomatic channels, for the performance of your duties.
When you fall out of line, what are the sanctions?
I would suggest that not be part of this discussion, because there are certain things around it which it depends on how the sovereign state decides to respond to it. And that is a matter exclusively for the government and for the Minister of Foreign Affairs. I'm sure you are aware that yesterday the foreign minister appropriately called a meeting of ambassadors accredited to this country and spoke in general terms. So we hope that Nigerians will be the sole carriers and purveyors of the effort to restore democracy to our country. No one, as the minister said yesterday, could love this country more than Nigerians love this country. We are a democratic people who want to have democratic government in place. And there is nothing whatsoever that this government has done that suggests in the slightest in the slightest way whatsoever, that it wants to detract from that particular perspective. All it needs is encouragement at this time, not trying to be holier than the Pope or trying to play a role which is totally incompatible with your diplomatic status, as we say.
Yemi, these very respected diplomats are saying that an ambassador or even the international community, representative of the international community in a country, have some rules and regulations,
correct,
some code of conduct. Don't you think that even though you've, because I assume that these monies came willingly, the aid they provided, they were not forced to bring this aid. Mm. Does that give them the authority to go as far as getting involved in the politics of the country?
I don't think it does, and I didn't say that it does. My initial point was just, and I still maintain that point, I think it's hypocritical if we acknowledge them when they say positive things, and then we denounce them when they're critical, and I stand by that. Mm-hmm. However, if I'm not an ambassador, so I wouldn't say that I know what the protocols or the rules that guide our behavior are. However, if you take Ambassador Entwistle, he did the Rivers Peace Accord, and then I think a week or two later, then did the one in Lagos. Now, for example, as you said, I mean, a sovereign nation has the right to respond in whatever way. I would have thought if, within the context that both the gentlemen have presented, after Rivers, then there's a bit of caution that, excuse me, we think you might be stepping over, or we're not comfortable with the role you're playing, such that a Lagos would not have occurred. So we had a Rivers, then we had a Lagos, then there was, which happened to tie to the criticism of the postponed elections, then there's suddenly a meeting and then a backlash. And I wonder at what point they did become an issue. At what point are we now paying attention to what they're saying or might not be saying? If John Kerry came in to have a meeting about elections, it wasn't that he came in on other things and elections happened to be a side attraction. He came in to have a meeting with both candidates about elections. Both of them showed up. He spoke quite candidly about what America's hopes and thoughts were for Nigeria's democratic process. And when it was then postponed and there were issues, Nigerians were talking about it. It wasn't, yes, you're right, Pakistan has elections in Iran, and that's precisely why Nigerians are asking, why is security such an issue if the security state hasn't changed in the last 2 years? So if then there's an opinion expressed on that in an official statement, why is that an issue?
But Ambassador Aderele, let me, Yemi keeps going back to this meeting with, the U.S. Secretary of State, Kerry. Yes, he keeps going back. Was there anything diplomatically wrong with that meeting?
If I can just comment about this, giving technical aid to INEC. It's a universal practice.
There's nothing wrong with it.
The government of a country can assist another government on any issue. But that doesn't confer on the ambassador of that country the right to interfere in the local politics of the same country. With regard to visit of the U.S. Secretary of State, it was a stopover, really. There's nothing bad in any one offering advice on any issue. In fact, he was highly privileged that our president received him. He should have been received by the Minister of Foreign Affairs, his colleague and counterpart in Nigeria, who maybe could have arranged his meeting with the contestants in a much more subtle form. There's tension in the air in Nigeria. It's not caused by Nigerians. This is why I said the genesis of our problem is that prediction of Nigeria's breakup in 2015. That is why the whole world seems to be
on edge.
Edge over Nigeria.
And all the activities seem to have so much connection to that.
Can I come in?
Let me give you the last word in just a minute, please.
But what I want to say is this, look. This is a sovereign nation, 54 years old. a country that has done so well, if you ask me. History is something that all of us can read up in books. A country of such complexity and diversity as Nigeria, to have played the role that it has played in global and national affairs, in the way that this country has done, is truly credible.
Okay.
What hurts some of us is the pathological attitude of Nigerians, who without Nigeria would be nothing, but who spend all their time denigrating themselves and abusing themselves. A generation of Nigerians who do not see anything good in what they are, except through the prism foisted on them by the external environment.
Okay, Your Excellency, I think we'll end it here. We end it here. We have some gifts for you.
Yes, it's Excellency, this is just a mug.
Thank you very much.
Yes, it's just as a guest on the O&M show.
As a guest on the O&M.
Yes.
Thank you, sir.
Pleasure.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Yemi?
Thank you very much.
This for you.
Thank you.
When you get back to Lagos,
yes,
let it be on your desk.
Ambassador Aderele.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much for coming.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. We'll take a break. When we return, we'll be looking at the preparedness or otherwise of INEC. Don't go away.
I hear in Nigeria, nothing is happening. Nothing is working. Nothing is making sense. When I look in Nigeria, I see the economy is growing. Young people have better opportunities. The farmers are rejoicing. Transportation is getting better and better. The roads are better than they have been in a long, long time. So why are they lying? Why are they covering the truth? Where is the integrity? Where is the patriotism? Maybe that's why they don't want to debate. People, think about the truth. Think Nigeria. Vote. Good luck, Jonathan, for president. This message is brought to you by Wind of Hope.
You're still watching the O&M Late Show, and joining us is Oluwole Osaze-Uzzi, the Director of Voter Education of INEC. Glad you were able to make it.
Welcome.
Thank you so much.
Please sit down.
Thank you.
Well, no discussion holds in Nigeria today without talking about the postponed elections and the backlash and the reactions and all that. But a lot of Nigerians are still worried. The postponement, has it put us in a better pedestal to have a more credible, free, fair, and peaceful elections?
Well, there are two ways of looking at that. It's the same glass, is it half full or half empty? Are we worse off for it? That's another perspective to it. Are we worse off for it? I don't think so. I certainly don't think so. Certainly not on the long run, I don't think we are. And come March 28th, maybe the outcome of that will probably be the best judge of whether we're in a better position or not. But certainly, because I think Professor Jigar Chema answered that question last week Saturday when he announced the rescheduling of the elections. I said, look, in the face of all that had been said, could any responsible organization go ahead with the conduct of elections? In view of the strong advice given by the security forces who are constitutionally charged with the security of this country, could we have gone ahead of that? The right to vote is a fundamental right acknowledged. But the other issue is the right to life. in the hierarchy of rights, as the political science and lawyers tell you, in the hierarchy of rights, the right to life is the most fundamental of rights. It is those who have the right to life, who live, who can enjoy what millions should be secondary rights, but the other rights
to vote. There.
Would you, because of the right to vote, endanger people, the voters, the election officials, the security forces, the observers, the media? Would you want to endanger those people because of the right to exercise a franchise? Would any responsible organization do that, as akin to a family? If you knew there was danger outside and those charged with the security tell you that, look, please don't go to this side. We think we cannot guarantee your safety, your security. Would you allow a family member go there?
You would not, of course.
So that's
now.
That's that.
But, you know, after Professor Jagar's press briefing last Saturday, a lot has come up after that. Yes. I mean, immediately after that, we saw, you know, that in fact, this talk about security was not the real issue, and that the postponement was indeed a lifeline handed over to INEC. And, you know, Professor Jagar did say a few things that, you know, INEC had its own internal issues. You had problems with your vendors and contractors not meeting deadline. Yes. And there are people who are saying now that the problem at INEC is a lot more, deep down than Nigerians were made to believe, and that actually it's INEC that was not ready for the elections.
Why didn't they wait for INEC to say so themselves?
But we waited for you in 2011. You started, and on the date of the election, you postponed.
Yes, indeed, we did.
So
and
that,
it was the
that
right thing
probably was going to happen
were
again.
Were we better off for that postponement or not? Was the country better off for it?
Yes, but I'm answering your question. You said, why not wait for it?
We should be courageous enough to accept when things are going wrong and when we cannot fulfill our mandate. And I think it took a bold act of courage to have done so in 2011. Yes, it did happen.
So what are the challenges of INEC right now?
Again, last Saturday, we acknowledged some of those challenges. There are some that you can say are internal, and there are some that are external. The internal thing, and the most worrisome, it's about the cards. But not to the perspective most people are looking at these cards. Enough time has been given to people to collect cards, and we keep extending that time. But the few, less than 1% now, whose cards are not in the field, that is worrisome. That is a challenge, and we expect that that should be resolved soonest.
Yeah,
that is internal to INEC, and we acknowledge that. But as to other issues and milestones, we're keeping and meeting our milestones as they got closer to the elections. If we'd gone ahead, it probably would not have been perfect, and we acknowledge that. Professor Jagar acknowledged that when he gave his broadcast to the nation. And now says this extension has afforded us the opportunity of perfecting those things that probably will not have been perfect. I think there's a level of integrity and honesty and openness, transparency in all that has been said. He admitted before the Council of States, before Nigerians, that look, yes, these things are not perfect. Yes, 34% of people had not collected their cards. Now that's an external circumstance for INEC. We've tried to give it as much publicity, made these cards available. Millions of those cards are just lying down there. Fortunately, there has been a gradual increase even since last Saturday.
Yes. Okay, one of the issues that has affected, in quotes, credibility of INEC in the collection of these PVCs is the disparity in the collection rate in the Northeast that is bedeviled by crisis,
yes,
and the Southeast and South-South, for instance, that are
and
not
even
as
the Southwest and Lagos that is
you
really politically
what I mean. Can you
aware.
You are an insider.
Yes.
What magic did INEC do in the Northeast to achieve that level of collection
distribution, yes,
and distribution? And why did they have issues achieving those in these other areas? Maybe it will help. Because
let me first of all say we're not magicians. I don't know of any magician in INEC. So we'll just follow processes. I must make a point. But having said that,
yes,
and let me draw a distinction between distribution and collection.
Okay.
In the distribution, I think this problem was fairly even nationwide. But there's observed disparity in the collection. And there are many factors responsible for this. I don't know whether it's even lies with INEC to even explain those factors. We don't have all the answers. But you know the demographics of Lagos, traffic and everything else. I don't know whether that offers an explanation for some of the issues. As for the Northeast, we're a bit proactive in the distribution in the Northeast. We knew there were camps. We knew there was some a lot of people who had been displaced. And we're, in the terms of distribution, we tried to get to the people in that regard. It's a special area, special circumstances, special situation, but not so in others, in other areas. Yes. But if you look at the current figures, you'll find out that disparity is not really there.
Okay. Did INEC pass these PVCs through MAs and individuals in the north? Because that's been the accusation, that INEC had given them to the MAs, to traditional rulers, to further do the distribution.
The process was uniform throughout the country in terms of there was no collection by proxy. That is not to say that some people did not disregard the directives, but officially, no, certainly not. It was a uniform process. You give it to these people. Anybody who comes with TVC collects a card. Anybody who he or she doesn't come with TVC, you fill an incident form, and then you still collect your card. And all this hue and cry, if you look at the statistics from those elections like Anambra, where the PVC was used for the first time, if you look at Ekiti, look at Osun, we do not have a higher percentage than we do now. But nobody said anything about it. Osun, the highest percentage collection, did not even get to 65% of collection.
Before the election?
Before the election. But nobody made any show of it. Why?
Maybe because we're just dealing with one state. Now it's national. And everybody. And
yes, but the principles still apply nationwide, regardless of whether it's one state, one constituency, or nationwide.
All right. What is the strategy that INEC is going to employ now to ensure? Because even if you leave those PVCs till December, there are Nigerians who will just not bother to go and pick it up.
Correct.
Now, what is the strategy that INEC is putting in place now? I mean, with the benefit of this in the next 5 weeks, to ensure that more and more people are sensitized enough to go and get that card.
We'll do our best, but I really wonder whether it is a lack of sensitization. I really wonder. You see, collection of cards and voting registration in this country are not mandatory, unlike in some other countries.
So do we need to make it mandatory?
Well, it's not for us to say. If it's mandatory, we'll comply with the law. We don't make the laws. We try to influence the laws for the betterment of what we think is society. But it's to you and I, as Nigerian citizens, to decide maybe this should be mandatory or not. There's a level of disillusionment with the system, obviously, and it happens everywhere. I was reading an article in one of the foreign papers the other day, and it said, look, in California, because of the last elections they had and the low turnout, they were looking at incentives to get people to come out to vote, and included giving them money. Or tax breaks, tax reliefs, and things like that. So it's not a situation that's peculiar to Nigeria. It's almost a worldwide phenomenon. It's a topical issue in the UK now, which has elections in a couple of months as well. This participation of people. Whether it should be mandatory, I don't know. Some neighboring countries, it is mandatory to vote. It's mandatory to register.
Put in such things like, if you don't have your PVC, you can't register your child in school. Mm-hmm. You know, things like that.
People do that, but I don't know about the legality of that.
And if the government makes it legal, it becomes legal.
I guess so. But you see, there's lots of responsibilities, like tax paying. Maybe if you said you must do this to get, then it's not for INEC to say that.
Oh, of course.
It's for the lawmakers to say.
We've heard people, very prominent politicians, mm-hmm. suggest, yes. Especially there was a suggestion from the PDP, yes. saying that maybe we should go back to the temporary cards. Is it a possibility? Is it something INEC is considering at all?
It is not something that's been considered, no. When you look at it, the TVC does not contain your biometrics. If we were to make this process better, if we were to stamp out a lot of malpractices that occur, a TVC cannot be read by the card reader. It does not contain your biometrics. So in theory, people can use TVC to vote more than once, but a PVC, you can't do that. These are some of the revolutionary things that have been introduced to make our electoral process better. So sometimes when politicians say certain things, we must look at where they are coming from. Is it that they don't want technology that will improve the process? Or is it a genuine concern that some Nigerians I'm willing to pick up the cards, I may not be allowed to vote.
Possibility for rigging is greater with the temporary.
It's certainly.
Certainly. Yes. Yes, sir.
Do I have? Well, maybe I should have the last word.
Yes.
And I'll ask the question. Is INEC prepared for March 28?
We are preparing. We'll be certainly prepared on that day. Yes.
All right. Okay. Thank you, Mr. Osaze.
I'm sure that before March 28, we'll have you here
we'll
again.
We'll have
we have to talk.
Yes, a week before.
Congratulations. Yes, it will be my pleasure.
A week before.
Thank you so much.
All right. It's for coming on the show.
That's a good one. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
I don't get gifts too often for coming on the show, so you guys come more often. Thank you. It's a pleasure.
Thank you.
For your desk and the INEC office.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay.
Well, I don't know. It's Valentine's Eve.
Yes, and a lot is going to happen tomorrow. And a lot of people are going to be going out even tonight.
I was going to ask if you're taking the team out tonight.
Well, tell you the truth, we have to take a break and just shut down for the night.
Okay. It's been a wonderful show.
Yes.
And don't forget that if you've missed the show tonight or missed part of it, you can go to our online TV portal, www.hblnews.com.
Yes.
And you can reach us on other social media.
Yeah, exactly.
I am Obiora Ilo from Abuja, Nigeria, thanking you for being part of this.
And of course, on Sunday, 2 p.m., we will be back with the O&M Sunday Show. My name is Mahmoud Akuga. Bye for now.